My name is Tom Brown.
And what was your role at Linda McKinley?
My role at Linda McKinley was assistant principal, and I was there from starting in September of 1968 until 1971 of June.
Okay, and can you tell us, how did you come to be placed at Linda McKinley?
Well, I was a coach, and we were going through the civil rights movement, and the assistant superintendent asked me to come and take part and represent the Columbus Public Schools as being head of the National Alliance of Businessmen. That's when they were dealing with jobs and a lot of civil rights problem. So I did that for a year, and that was a pretty awesome job. What the job was really consisted of, we met, me and two other teachers. We would go to the community centers, and when the black parents had concerns and they were complaining about what the Columbus Public Schools wasn't doing, and they gave us a little book of all the good things. And every time we would tell them about all these things, they would, after the meeting, say that, you know, that's not true. But anyway, once that program was over, Mr. Dummery, who was assistant superintendent, I told him, I said, you know, because he said, now, if you have to go to shopping or something during the day, go ahead. But, you know, I'd go shopping and I'd see a parent and say, Mr. Brown, why aren't you in school? Because all our work was at night meetings. So I told him I'd like to get back into the schools and work with kids, students, because that's really what I wanted to do. So they were looking for black administrators. So Mr. Dummery said, well, we'd like for you to go to Linda McKinley because we're going to move an assistant principal out. And so I said, fine. So I didn't have to go through the cadet program. They have a cadet program. So I was getting going in as position of assistant principal, but they didn't have any, they were going to not pay me as assistant principal. So I went back to Mr. Dummery and I said, look, I'm filling the job. I expect to be paid. So they had to go before the board, and then they said, fine, we'll pay him. So that's how I got to Linda McKinley as assistant principal.
And so can you talk about your relationship with the administration once you were there, with the larger administration?
You mean downtown or at the school?
Both.
Well, at the school, we had three, it was Terry Steele, Mr. Reed, who was a principal, and myself. We had a good team. Now, Mr. Reed was the principal and a very nice person, but he didn't know how to deal with what was really happening, what the student body was talking about. Because what was happening is that Lyndon McKinley was used to be predominantly white. The black community moved from the east to the Linden area. That's when they were buying homes. Now, I had a lot to do because Mr. Reed, Mr. Steele, myself, but we had a good team. But we were dealing with a staff of probably 80 teachers, and we only had like 11 black teachers. So it was really a culture type of thing that culture changed, because a lot of the teachers, they had black students at Linda McKinley, but an influx of a lot of people moved up there. And it was really a culture thing that Mr. Reed had problems with. He just turned everything over basically to Mr. Steele and I. And so, because he would let us handle things. So it was a good, we had a good administrative staff. Everybody, Mr. Reed was willing to listen. He just didn't understand where the young guys were coming from. So it was a good relationship.
And can you say, was there racial tension in the school? I mean, you talked about the change in demographics that was happening in the community. Did you feel racial tension in the school?
Oh, there had to be, because once you get a population of 50% black and 50% white, it becomes a power struggle. Who's going to be the homecoming queen? We never had a black, they had a black homecoming queen before I got there, but there's a power struggle between the black youngsters and the white youngsters. So that's a normal thing, because you're 50%. So the blacks wanted things done one way, the white other. So there was tension. Now, I had a lot to do with how that community changed, and Morton probably didn't know. I had dual careers. I was probably the first black mortgage banker in the country, okay? I did a lot of financing. I bet I financed 400 homes in the Linden community. I lived on 23rd, right in the community, but I was a mortgage banker also during the summer, and also I revolutionized that business, because when you apply for a home loan, FHA or VA, you'd have to make an appointment, go downtown, take a half a day off. So I couldn't do that during the school, so I would tell the real estate salesman, you write the contract, give me the telephone number to your prospective buyers, and they wouldn't have to take off from work. After school, I'd go past. They thought that was great. Guys downtown didn't like it, but that's how I got over. But I had a lot to do with the people coming in that community. And the parents would say, I know you from somewhere. And I would never say that I financed a home, but I had a lot to do with the changing of that community. So it was a, tension was in the school, and I understand exactly why it was there. And that's why they wanted a black administrator, because the kids wanted somebody to relate to. Terry Steele was an assistant. He was a white administrator, and he had been used to working at Mohawk High School, and he was used to dealing with black youngsters, so he was on top of his game there. And really, the student body kept us informed all the time what was going on, because we were willing to listen and understand. We were being educated too now, but there was tension. And that's why we were there. So
then, can you talk a bit about you as a person, what your sense was of the political and social turmoil that was happening in the country at the time while you were living in McKinley? What were your feelings about what was happening in the United States?
Well, I was pretty much aware of what was going on. Now, I went to a black college, Central State University, so I was pretty much aware of the situation, because my department chairman said every night he wanted everybody to listen to the news. So I was pretty much aware of what the civil rights problems were. Remember, they killed King in 68, assassinated King. So I was very much aware. And things I weren't not aware of, Charles Ross, who was the head of the Black Studies Department at Ohio State, he kept us all informed. So I was pretty much on top of things, but I was learning as I moved along. I was young, I was 32 years old. Matter of fact, Martin and those guys and my little student secretary, said, Mr. Brown, you've got to grow an afro. So I grew an afro. I did not know how to use a pick. So every morning she'd come in, Mary Davis, I'll never forget. She said, no, Mr. Brown, you gotta buy a pick. You know, go to the drugstore and bring a pick and I'll show you how to pick. So I was growing up too now, but it was a great experience.
So, can you tell us how you think your presence along with the presence of Gary Davis and Bruce Bunch, affected the black students at Lyndon McKinley, and for that matter, the white students as well?
The good thing about Gary Davis and Bunch, both of them went to Central State. They studied black history, and they majored in black history. We were fortunate enough to get them on the staff. Lyndon McKinley was the first school to have black studies, and Davis and Bunch were the two teachers. They related well to the black kids and the white kids, because they were real nice people. So we were fortunate to have them, and they had a great impact. John and Martin, they listened to them tell us, they helped us on what we ought to be thinking and what was really happening. So they had a great influence on us and the school.
And how do you think that your presence affected the students there?
Well, I guess one, being black, two, I was interested in the kids and I listened to them and I knew some of the things that they were going through, because a lot of things were caused because there was a culture change on the staff. So they would tell me, Mr. Reed, for example, said, Ron, I want you to talk with the black students and find out what some of their concerns are that doesn't cost money. Because everybody was always talking about we can't have black study because the system didn't have any money for it. So one of the things that one of the students said, that we wish that the teachers would call us young men instead of boys. So I made a note of that. So we had a teachers meeting and I was given a report to what some of the concerns of the black youngsters. And one of the things that stood out, I said, one of the things that the young men would like if the teachers would refer to them as young men instead of boys. And Mr. Shirley, one of the teachers, said, Mr. Brown, let me tell you something. He was an older teacher. I've been calling them boys all my life, and I'm never going to change calling them boys. So you can forget that idea. So I said to myself, we got a real problem here with that gentleman. But those are some of the things that, what my responsibility was. And Terry, the other sister, we were always on the same page. So, and then we ran together as friends. Our families socialized together. So we had a real good relationship there.
There was a group of students, a group of black students, who in 71, they wanted change, right? They wanted these changes, and they started meeting regularly at John Wells' house. So I wanted to know, were you aware of this group and the fact that they were meeting? What your understanding was of what they wanted?
Oh, I knew they were meeting because the next day they'd come in and talk to us, Mr. Horton, the counselor, our head custodian was Greenfield, and he was a part of it. So they kept us informed on what they were talking about. So it was never, we were never left in the dark. Now, when they wanted to keep a secret, they kept a secret. But they knew that they could come and talk to us. So I knew that, we all knew that they was meeting at John's house, because John and Whitaker and a little girl, last name was Washington. But they were meeting with students at John's house. So we were aware of it.
Laura.
And so can you, oh, I'm sorry, I thought you froze for a second. Can you tell us a little bit of your memories of those students, of John Wells, John Whitaker, Mark Morton, Valora Washington, Zola Diggs?
They were probably, I was in education for 32 years. They were probably the most intelligent young folks that I had ever met. They were on top of their game. They knew the history of things. They knew about Malcolm X. They knew about Stokely Carmichael. They were very much aware of what was going on. And they were educating us also, because that group was probably the best group of kids that I've ever worked for. One of the students became the superintendent of Columbus Public Schools. Harris, she became the superintendent. Every one of those kids have been very successful out in the world. They were brilliant kids. They know what they were talking about. And they had a mind of their own. Only thing I never will forget, Mr. Horton. I think Martin really said it. Mr. Horton said, now, they would come up with an idea, and Mr. Horton said, now, you know what, I'm with you, but I can't go along with that. I can't go along with being with you on that. And I think Wells or somebody said, well, Mr. Horton, if you ain't with us, who are you with? You know, so that straightened that situation out. But brilliant kids. I've never met any brighter kids. Lyndon McKinley youngsters were ahead of every high school in Columbus when it came to being aware of the movement.
So, Mr. Brown, I'm going to go into February and ask you if you could tell us your memories of the Black History Week performance in February of 71, and tell us what happened, what you saw.
Well, I thought they did a great job. It was awesome. The thing that we had going for us was Bruce Bunch and Gary Davis. They had a background and they majored in Black history. So they were very much aware. So they helped the kids come up with an outstanding program, and some of the teachers were in tune to it. So it was an awesome week, actually a month of Black history. And a lot of the white teachers were educated on what was really happening in Black history, because they never had taken any courses in that. So it was outstanding.
So can you tell us about the play that was, the performance that happened, and the incident with the flyers?
Okay, the play that the kids, the drama department put on? Is that the one you're talking about? Oh, that was awesome.
Yeah, I'm talking about the play when the flyers were dumped over the balcony, that performance.
Wait a minute, say that again, please.
I said I was talking about the play that was going on when the flyers were dumped over the balcony, when the white student dumped the flyers over.
Oh. That was we had a play in auditorium with the drama department. Young teacher was in charge of the drama department, and she was awesome. They were way ahead of their times on that. And then somebody dumped, a young kid from the balcony dumped some flyers over. So I don't know if we stopped it, if I can remember, or we just overlooked it and we went over and found out who it was and took them out. But it was an outstanding program, because she was the young teacher. I mean, she was tuned right in to what was happening.
And so were you there when that incident happened?
Yeah, I was in the auditorium. We were always...
And do you remember can you describe what happened, what you saw?
Well, what I saw, somebody with some Confederate dumped it over the balcony. Okay, and naturally we went right to that, and I removed them from the auditorium. It did upset the kids, but eventually they settled back down. So, but I remember that situation.
Okay, and then a little bit later in the year, in May, Can you tell us about the march from Linda McKinley High School to Franklin Park on May 19th to celebrate Malcolm X's birthday? What was your role in that, and tell us what it was like?
Well, the leaders, Wells and Martin and John Wicker, they let us know they were celebrating Malcolm X's birthday. And they said, we're going to march, to leave school and go down to Franklin Park, which is where they were having speeches and stuff. So that night, you know, I worried about it because I know Deepatoon was SWAT for the police department. And I knew if they had a chance, they'd bang some of the kids upside the head if they did something wrong. So we had 11 black teachers on the staff. I called every one of them and told them I was going to have a meeting at my house. So they all came over and we talked about it. And we came to the conclusion that we needed to go with those kids because, you know, that if they're out there by themselves, something would happen and give the police a good opportunity to harass him. So we all decided to go. That morning, John and the leaders, now the leaders were, it was three or four guys. Now let me tell you how that turned out. They adopted the philosophy of multiple leadership because when Kane got assassinated, we almost fell apart as black folks in the whole country. So that's how that came about, multiple leadership. So they had an assembly. They took over the PA system. We had a room where you could broadcast throughout the school. They took that over and made an announcement and said, we have an assembly. Everybody report to the auditorium. So everybody reported to the auditorium. So when we get to the auditorium, I'd already, you know, was up there. So Mr. Reed couldn't do anything. They were on the way down the auditorium. So we're all in the auditorium, student body and all. And John said, we're going to march. And if Mr. Brown tell us, or any of the teachers tell us to do something, we expect you to do it. Stay on the sidewalk. You know, don't cause a traffic problem. So we went that morning. Then Mr. Reed was going to say something. Unfortunately, I felt so sorry for him. And when Mr. Reed got to the mic, John said, let's go. Everybody walked out the auditorium and away we went. So everything went fine down Cleveland Avenue, hit Broad Street and up to the park. The interesting thing that happened on that was the next day, the superintendent called me down because we had to go past East High School, which was a all-black high school. And Mr. Gibbs had mentioned, somebody mentioned that we tried to pull the black kids out of East High School to join us, and we didn't. We just had to go past them to get to the park because the park was right across the street. So Dr. Iberlin, who was the superintendent, I'll never forget, I came down there, and it was Mr. Dummer who was in there, Dr. Iberlin, and Dr. Iberlin banged his fist on the desk. He says, Mr. Brown, as far as I'm concerned, you can put your resignation on my desk right now. Now, he was going to retire that year. He had 45 days left. And I said, I got up and I said, you know what, you only have 45 days left. You think I'm going to give you my resignation? So, you know, you can start. And Mr. Dummer thought we were going to fight. And, you know, he got up to his, wait a minute. So we finally settled down. And so I said to him, he said, Mr. Gibbs said you tried to pull his kids out of school. I said, Mr. Gibbs did not speak for all black folks, so don't tell me about what Mr. Gibbs is saying. You know, I don't want to hear about that. So we dismissed and went back to went back to school. And that's what happened, Malcolm X's birthday. They had speeches out there.
A few days after that, Do you recall a community meeting that happened on May 24th? And could you talk about the purpose of that meeting and describe what happened there?
A meeting
It was at a church, and I also would like to ask you if you recall it being at Mount Hermon Baptist Church or Bethel AME.
If I'm not mistaken, Reverend Dowdy was at Mount Hermon. He was a pastor at Mount Hermon. And I think we were at Mount Hermon. Now, what happened there is that they were trying to put policemen in the building. We didn't want policemen in the building. McCain was a guy who was working with the black youngsters, and he was a part of stirring up the trouble. But the day before, we had a meeting with the police chief and about putting police officers in the building. And evidently they had a meeting that night at the church that the parents were going to come up and march the next day because they didn't want policemen in the building. So I got a call late at night, and I can't remember who, and said, you know, Mr. Brown, they're going to meet at the church tomorrow morning. And the parents, they're going to collect money so that if anybody got put in jail, they could bail them out. And they were going to have it, and they were going to march, meet at the church and march. So I said, I got up early, and I said, where are you going? I said, I got to go over to the church. I said, because they're walking right into a trap. I said, because the police wanted them to come up there so that they could cause a disturbance and prove that they needed policemen in the building. So when I got to the church, Reverend Dowdy was talking and a few people made speeches. And this is an incident where I saw my whole life pass before me. So Reverend Dowdy said, well, we have the young administrator from Linden. He wants to say a few words. So I got up and started explaining. I said, you shouldn't come. I said, you know, they're waiting on you because all they wanted you to do is cause a disturbance so they could put policemen in the building and arrest somebody if somebody would act up. Please don't come. We can handle it. We'll keep you informed. Because the kids really, the leaders were really ahead of the parents. Parents would call some Mr. Brown, what are we supposed to do? I said, look, they know what they're doing. You know, we may not like it as adults, but they're on top of their game and what they wanted to do and what they wanted to see happen in the school. So Reverend Dowdy grabbed the mic from me, I'll never forget, and he said, this is what I'm talking about. Says they done sent down this Uncle Tom to tell us not to come. And I saw my whole life pass before me. And I'll never forget, Ross came up to me and said, it's okay, man, just go back to school. We got you covered. We're gonna make sure, they had about 15 brothers, we're gonna make sure nothing happens. And we'll be up there as security people to make sure that the kids stay intact and none of the parents cause a problem. So that's happened. That's what happened, came of that meeting when they were gonna put policemen in the building. One of the things that happened about the policemen in the building, what they were a little upset about, is that they put 10 policemen officers on special duty. They were there in the morning. And so the room off to the cafeteria manager gave them coffee and everything. And so they were sitting in there smoking. You weren't supposed to smoke in the building. Do you know John Wells and them locked the 10 policemen in the room? And I said, we got the word at the office that, you know, the policemen were trying to get out because they locked them in the room. And they came out of there like they were highly upset. And we were telling them, man, you guys shouldn't have done that. They're really going to jump on our case now about the policemen being in the building. So that was a funny experience. And they called and said, Mr. Brown, they had locked the policemen up in the room off the cafeteria. So we had to go down there and open the doors. But that was an interesting experience.
So can you talk about your memories of the flag being switched, the flag outside Linda McKinley High School being switched? Tell us about what you knew, what you saw, how you felt.
Okay. I heard one version that the flag, somebody put the flag up that night and the fire department took it down. Now, when the mayor came out to the school, that was after school, the day before the flag went up. The mayor came out, I think Hughes, who's head of the police department, the fire department chief came out, and somebody from downtown came out. And this is after school, we're down in the boiler room, we're just having this meeting. And the fire department chief says, look, I know how we can solve this problem about this flag. And they said, we will put hog grease on the flagpole so they can't go up the flag. And I'm sitting up there, I said, boy, they're being awful interested in that flag. So they said, well, that's what we'll do. And we'll have the big ladder fire truck sitting on Cleveland Avenue. And if anything, if the flag gets up, we'll be able to come right away and take it down. So the next morning, I didn't know when the flag was going up. So one of the leaders came up to me and said, Mr. Brown, the flag's going up at 8:30. Stay clear of us. Maybe I shouldn't say this, but I was supervising in the rear of the building. And I knew what stay clear of us meant. So when they looked out the door, they said, dang, they got grease on the flagpole. And those leaders went right up to the third floor. And all of us remember the big windows, and when they used to have a big pole with a hook on it, you pull the shades down. They got the pole out of the classroom and opened the window, stuck the pole out the window, grabbed the chain, pulled the American flag in, detached it from the chain, hooked the black nationalist flag, which was red, green, and black, sent it back out there, and everybody started cheering, and that big fire truck with the big ladders came right across our pretty lawn, full speed, stopped at that pole and sent them ladders up, and that flag came down. But the kids had already started applauding. But that's what happened on the flag that I had to deal with. So I heard it enough. Go ahead.
And that was during the day?
Yeah, that was 8:30 in the morning. And one of the leaders came up. And when I came in the building, just walked past me and said, Mr. Brown, it's going up at 8:30, stay clear of us. And I know what that meant, you know.
And so, can you tell us about the police coming to the building? Did the police show up after that fire truck came and changed the flag?
That was a different time. We were having an assembly, and the word got it that Charles Ross was in the building. And Kelsey was, I think, with him. He was in the Black Citizens Department at Ohio State. And they came in the building and they arrested Charles Ross. And the kids were upset. And then they had the troops standing outside and they just stormed in the building. And the teachers were trying to get the kids out of the hall. And they came through with them sticks, billy clubs, and was hitting everybody they could. And the teachers were trying to get the kids in the room, and that was a rude awakening for the teachers who had been talking with the kids, because the teachers always felt that the policemen and the fire people were nice people, and they liked the policemen. But the black youngsters were telling the teachers that, no, it's not that way. They treat us a lot different than they treat you. And they actually saw it. Some of their best students got hit upside the head with clubs. But there was one black police officer, he was actually a detective. And he was a part of the group. And he was going around swinging. And a young man had a board. And he was coming down the hall. And that young brother stepped out there and cold cocked that police and ran. He ran in the room. The teachers tried to lock the door. He ran, and they, on the first floor, the windows were open, and they were, kids were jumping out the window because the police was coming in there chasing them. But that was a horrible day to see that the kids, they were just beating the kids, whoever was in the hall, and the teachers were trying to get them out of the halls. And so that was not.
What was going through your mind when you saw all of that?
Oh, I was out there telling everybody, get out of the way, man. You know, telling the kids, get in the rooms, you know. So it was frightening to me that what was happening. So Terry was out there, the other assistant, we was telling the kids, get in the room, man, because this, you know, this is something out of control. But that's when the head custodian got arrested, Greenfield. And Dave Page, I think he got arrested. So took them downtown. But that was a horrible experience, you know, a frightening one too.
And can you talk about the rest of the school year after that police raid, and also talk about your arrest?
Well, after they shut the school down, they were saying that they weren't going to have a graduation, and they were going to have finals. First group of finals, ninth graders would come to school and take finals. Next day, 10th grade, next day, 11th graders, fourth day, seniors, taking finals. So one of the parents of the ninth grader came over to pick up her kid, and like other parents were, and she wanted to go into the building to get her son. And so the policeman said, you can't go in there. She said, well, my son is in there, I'm going in there. So they grabbed her and handcuffed her to a small chair in the hall. She started having a heart attack. So she said, Mr. Brown, send somebody out to my car to get the nitroglycerin that you put under your tongue. And I told Mr. Page, I said, man, go out to the car right quick and get her nitroglycerin. Now they've got a handcuff to back in the chair. Now the next thing I thought of, now her son was 6'5", played football, and he was a freshman. And I said, if this kid comes downstairs and see him have his mother handcuffed like that, they were gonna kill him, because he would go off. So I started up on the third floor where the ninth graders were taken. I didn't know what classroom he was in. So when I started upstairs, three policemen followed me up. And when I started looking in classrooms, they had, I guess, radioed, and three other policemen came up the front stairs. So when I left the second room, the policeman, won't mention his name, but put his finger in my chest and started poking me and said, who are you? And I said, you know who I am. I'm an administrator here. No, I asked you who you are. You're supposed to have a badge on, because I had taken my sport coat off. And he did it again. And I had it right up to here. And the next thing I know, he pushed me and I cold cocked him, and the other five policemen jumped in the fight. And to be honest, that was the easiest fight I ever been in, because I was able to throw them around. I could have threw them down the steps. I said, no, they'd shoot me. And then the one policeman pulled his gun. I thought he was going to shoot me, and he shot me right in the face with the mace gun. And when they shoot you in the eyes with the mace gun, you go down. And I still have knots on my head where I took a whip in that one. John Farley and Chris Boyles both jumped on me, those are two teachers, to cover me up, because they said, stop beating him. And they jumped on top of me, and they got arrested. And I'll never forget, the officer came up, the sergeant came up and said, what kind of charges can we put on him? And sergeant said, well, shotgun, all 33 charges. That's how I got to 33 charges. Now, when we went through court, we had the trial, I ended up with one charge, which was disturbing the peace. And I know why I got that, because I couldn't sue anybody after the whipping I took. But they put us in the paddy wagon and started taking us downtown. It was the three of us, John Farley, Chris Bowles, and myself. Now, Dayton is my hometown, and I knew what the policemen used to do in Dayton when they wanted to, being smart, they'd take you to the railroad tracks, cross the tracks with that rubber hose. So we're going down Cleveland Avenue, and they cut into where the fairgrounds were, and I said, oh Lord, it's going to be, somebody going to get a whipping, and I knew who it was going to be. So, and they were talking, yeah. A lot of them were angry because they were students. They graduated from Leonard McKinley years ago. So they were a little upset. And so I said, you know, I said to myself, I don't need to take a whipping because I had mace and stuff all in my eyes anyway. So I said, I know how you guys feel. I'm just trying to protect the kids so they don't get hurt. Because they had already, the two teachers didn't know what was going to happen because they'd already taken me out of the paddy wagon. And I said, I know what you guys are going through, man. I said, you know, I just happened to be involved. And I talked my way out of that whipping because they had the rubber hoses in their hand. I knew what that's about because you don't leave any marks on anybody. So we got back in the paddy wagon and down to the jail house we went. And then I had to call my attorney, my wife called it, because it was on the news and everything. And they bailed me out. I got home, the wife said, you okay? And my family room was full of kids. They were upset about it. I told them I'm okay. So that's what happened when I got arrested. Then we had a big trial. Counselor and those Jewish attorneys from New York came in to help out. So it worked out. I had to do 40 hours of community service and pay a fine, I think, for the one charge that got disturbing the peace in the school I was in. So.
And so what was the, I mean, that's a lot. You know, everything that you just described, that is a lot. What was the impact of that on you? Well, as an administrator, but also as a person.
See, what about the last, what did you say, the last part?
Say it again?
Repeat that, please.
Oh, sure. I just said that, you know, everything that you just described is a lot, you know, that experience. Mm-hmm. And I wondered if you could talk about how that impacted you as an administrator, but also as a person.
Well, I had to stay assistant principal for 8 years before they moved me up to a principal. That affected me there. The one emotional thing that, the only time it bothered me is that we were in the process of adopting my daughter. And I came home and asked the wife what was wrong. And she was upset because she said, Tom, they may not let us
take all the time you need.
They may not let us adopt her. It was going through the, I think, Lutheran Church or the Catholic Church, wherever the adoption agency was. And I'll never forget. The next morning I got up, went to the church, and told that, let me tell you, we've got black kids that need parents. And I don't even want to hear you tell me about it. You're not going to let me adopt my, that young baby that I, we had both sat with and got to be familiar with. And whoever was in charge of it said, don't worry, Mr. Brown, that will not affect that situation at all. So I got that straight, and I was able to go back and tell her that everything was going to be all right. But that sort of had an effect. That was probably the worst effect. Otherwise, I was a fighter anyway. My goal, when I first came to Columbus, I'd be talking to some of the brothers who were administrators, and they said, boy, I never thought I'd be an administrator, you know, in Columbus, a principal. And I said to myself, hell, I came to Columbus to be the superintendent of the Columbus Public Schools. That was my goal. But with that incident and Linda McKinley, I knew that that goal, that wasn't about to happen, because all of a sudden I became a militant. And I never will forget, they took us out of Linda McKinley, the whole administrative team, and they were trying to find a place to put us. So they were going to put me on the west side at a school called Hiltonia. And that group of people out there, those white folks said, you're not going to send that militant out to our school. So I ended up in the south end at Sophomore Middle School, and I did about 8 years there. Then I went to South High School as assistant, and Mr. Dumery, who had retired, came back from Florida because his son was the principal at South. When we were getting ready for graduation, he came up to me and he said, Tom, I'm going to see to it that you become a principal. And sure enough, he went downtown and I got promoted as a principal. At principal assignment was at Mifflin Junior High School. So I was on my way.
So Mr. Brown, can you talk to us a little bit about your memories of Charles Ross?
Oh, sure. First of all, after this whole situation was over, we played golf together and talked about situations the whole time that happened years back. But the relationship was a good relationship. He helped us. He gave us guidance on the direction. See, he got arrested too, so he had a big court case. But we got to be real good friends. He continued to be the head of the Black Studies at Ohio State, and then eventually he retired. But it was a good relationship. He helped us a lot. The one thing that I wanted to tell you about is that was pretty interesting. When about the the Black National Anthem. Now,
with Les Brown. I was going to ask you about that, about Les Brown.
Oh, okay, good. Well, Les Brown was a disc jockey for WCOL, a VKO. And I knew, first of all, I had met Les Brown because I financed his home, so I got to know him. Didn't have the best of credit, so I had to write a hell of a letter of explanation to FHA of why he had some things on his collection. But we got to be good friends, and he was the disc jockey. And the four leaders, Wells, Martin, and Whitaker, and the young lady, they were talking about in the classes and talking about the Black National Anthem. Now, the Black National Anthem really was lift every voice and sing. And a lot of the black youngsters didn't know that, and the white youngsters didn't know it either. So I said, the big discussion was, what is this about this song? So I called a radio station and said, hey, Les, do you have a CD or a copy of the Lift Every Voice and Sing? Because the kids, that's known as a black national anthem. And I want to explain to the kids, the student body, what everybody was talking about. So he says, well, after school, come on out and I'll give it to you. So when I got out to the station, he gave it to me. And I started out the door and he said, let me tell you, you got a lot of balls, man. Good luck, because I would never do that. I said, well, I'm going to put it over the PA system. And I, the next day, I went on the PA system and explained. I said, now, you can either stand up, sit down, whatever you do, the reason that we're playing this is that this has been something that nobody knew about, you guys, the students didn't know about, and this is the song that is as black, known as Black National Anthem. And respect whether some can stand up, sit down, or be silent, but let's respect everybody's voice and listen to, and let this be a learned experience. So we played it, and it went down well. So that was quite an experience that even a lot of teachers, well, white teachers never heard of it either. So, but it, that went down fine. And that's how I became good friends of Les Brown, and we're still friends. We talk every once in a while. You know, he married, what's the young lady who, head of the PIPs. A lady who was head of the
Gladys Knight.
Gladys Knight.
Really?
He married Gladys. You know that, didn't you? Yeah, he married Gladys Knight. So, but he was a heck of a motivation speaker. So, yeah, that's my story. How I know Les Brown.
So, Mr. Brown, can you also talk about your involvement in bringing black teachers to Linda McKinley High School or to Columbus City Schools in general, and why that was something that was that you felt was important?
I'm sorry to interrupt, Mr. Brown, look out for you to take that a little bit here. I went to look for tissue, but I couldn't find any.
Okay.
Did you have something that so you know? Thank you, sir.
Okay. I'm okay now?
Yes, it was good.
Well, we were trying to get more black teachers. Now, one, the Columbus Public School was trying to, that's when we were, the country was going through DSAG. They were trying to avoid to have to go into DSAG. And so we were trying to get black teachers at our school. Now, the phys ed teachers, girls phys ed teacher was leaving. And Mr. Reed said, you know, Tom, do you know anybody who is majored in phys ed, a black teacher? I said, the only one I knew is Linda Giles, and she was in my first sixth grade class when I started talking, but she went to Central State like I did. She was a junior majoring in phys ed. So I picked up the phone and called Dr. Lewis, who was the head of the physical education and the recreation department. She was the head. And she was my department chairman. So I called, I said, Dr. Lewis, I said, we need to get a black phys ed teacher. We got an opening. And I said, is anybody graduating? And I said, the only one I know who's a junior is Linda. And she said, well, she's a junior. She says, she hadn't even graduated. I said, well, can't you let her take some classes in the summertime? We can hire her and she can take the class and she'll get a degree. We'll make sure that she gets her degree, but she can go to summer school. So Dr. Lewis thought about it. She says, okay. And that's how we got Linda Giles. And I'm sure you remember that. That's how we got her as a teacher. So that worked out fine. We were beginning to get more and more black teachers into the school, which was fine. Now, as far as getting teachers for the system, Dr. Haar came in as a superintendent, and he was came in saying that we need to get more diversified and get more black teachers. So the teams that they were sending out to recruit at the different colleges, they would come back and say, well, we didn't see any black at the job fairs that they have at the college, didn't see any black teachers available. So Dr. Harris said, Brown called me, he said, I'd like for you to go and help do some recruiting. And Mr. Schroep, who was head of teacher personnel, he was from Gallipolis, he was a brother. And I want you to go get with him and you guys go to the job fairs. And we went to Michigan State, University of Michigan, and Wayne State at the job fairs. I saw one black teacher, and it was a gentleman, and he already had a job. So when we came back, we flew there and then got a Pinto, never get a Ford Pinto, and went to those job fairs. So when I came back, Dr. Harris had us talking to the board members. We had a meeting, and they asked about the experience. I said, well, we went to Michigan State, University of Michigan, and Wayne State, and I saw one black young man, and he already had a job. He was in English. And they said, well, that's what we're talking about tonight, aren't they? And I said, no, you got to go south. I said, because now I graduated from Central State, and a lot of my alpha brother was the president of Alabama A&M. A couple of the girls who were head of that I went to college with were head of the education department and teacher education. A couple of other guys were head of the different education departments. And so I would let them know that when I was coming, we were coming down. And I never forget one of the girls who was at Central State was head of the, I think it was A&T. She said, not only will the seniors be there, the juniors be there, the sophomores, and the freshmen will be there at the job fair. So we recruited. One of the things that about our Southern blacks is that they believed in higher education. So Columbus had a unique program. If you worked in the Columbus Public Schools, you could get your master's degree free. So that was the deal they worked out, because Ohio State, you could get a master's degree or a PhD free if you were in the system. Now, they worked it out because Ohio State was sending their student teachers to do their student teachers in our system. So it worked out, a win-win situation. So, but one thing that the parents, the black parents would say, Mr., when we were down there recruiting, said, Mr. Brown, boy, that's going a long way. And I said, well, one of the things is that your kids can get a free, get a master's or a PhD free. Now, they were worried about housing, so we called back to Columbus. We had a meeting, and a gentleman who's down there, forget his name, he was working downtown, and he took the responsibility. His job was to go out and find a nice apartment complex for the incoming teachers from the different schools in the South. So when they came, they had a place to stay, and it was not a rundown, it was a nice apartment. So we recruited 150 teachers that year. The funny part about it, and Mr. Schroep, who was in charge of the teachers, called me and he said, hey, Brian, he said, Grossman, who's head of the CEA, that was the teacher union, called and said, why didn't we let him know we recruited so many black teachers? And I said, man, don't worry about that. I said, we don't have to tell him. The system has already hired him, because they used to have a big luncheon for the new teachers. And all these folks showed up. And he said, how come y'all didn't tell me that you had that many black teachers? I told him, don't even worry about it. That's what we recruited. And the funny part, I told Schroep, he's a young country boy. I said, one, when we get off the airplane and person college went to his A&T, we're gonna rent a Cadillac. We're gonna have 3-piece suits on, looking sharp. When we walk in that administration building, we're gonna be about business and we're gonna get us some teachers. And also, I was the principal of Johnson Park, and I knew the black administrators would say, Brown, how you get so many good teachers? Now, I knew who was gonna be leaving. Like language arts teachers would be leaving. When I was down, I was looking for a language arts teacher. And I would tell Shrove, put that schedule that kid into my school. So that worked out fine, but it was a great experience. Working with different presidents at the colleges, and had a good experience. So that was my recruiting experience, and it worked out fine.
So I wanna go to this final question. I know we're tight on time and we're tight on battery too. So I wanna ask you, just to bring it to today, when you see the demonstrations and the movements that are happening now in 2020 against police brutality and racial violence and systemic racism, what are your thoughts when you see what's happening today in the United States and around the world?
Good question. Some changes are going to happen, and let me tell you why. The young folks are involved. The athletes are involved. The professional athletes. I was a professional ball player. Those guys in the barn. LeBron James is a godsend. Didn't go to college. Outstanding spokesman. They're involved. The whole world is involved. When they showed those films about on Floyd's neck, police officer there in plain daylight, that moved the whole world. See, a lot of young brothers have been killed and we knew nothing about. Fortunately, we got them on tape. But I think there's some changes that are going to be made. And if we have an administrative change in the White House, I think things will be fine. But I think some things are going to change because now the young brothers are understanding the power they have. They are young millionaires. They're going to pass the, put some pressure on the owners because it's all about money. And I'm excited and I'm scared too about who's going to win the election. So that's my feeling. And I think we are going to get some change.
And can you also speak to, since you say that, I mean, I'm thinking about movements happening in 2020 as opposed to back in 71. A lot of, you know, what we've heard has been about teen boys and young men who were both victimized and who were activists. But what about the girls? And I know that now we're looking at definitely an escalation of violence against black women by police as well. And we have, you know, Breonna Taylor killed in her own bed, and we have Sandra Bland killed in, you know, under the cover of this jail. And can you speak to that as well? And just kind of the role, how you see gender roles shifting in this movement?
Oh, good question. First of all, I have always felt that women were a lot smarter than men. The movement that's going on now, the women, to me, have always been the driving force. It used to be said that there was only two free people, the white man and the black woman. And let me tell you what, the sisters are out there now, and they're gonna get something done. So I just think it's a beautiful thing. And I've always said that I think women are a lot more smarter than we are. I used to tell people, I made all the major decisions. I've been married for 65 years. I made all the major decisions, like whether we went to war with Russia, China, or whoever. But the rest of the decisions was made about how I dressed, what we ate, were all made by my wife. So I've always thought, and they're involved too, so I think that's my feeling on that.
And from your perspective of having experienced things back then and seeing what's happening now, what do you see as the way forward, you know, in terms of resolution? And I mean, I heard you say that things are going to change, but what in your mind would be the best way for things to change?
There's so many ways. If we can get strong leadership at the top, if we can continue to get the young folks who are in power to continue to demand things that should change, I think we're going to be talking about a different world. And one of the things that the young folks are doing is that years ago, they used in education, they would ask the teachers to do or teach them this. The white youngster would demand it, that you give me a good education. Now, the black youngsters and women are saying, we demand that you give us an education. Not ask for it, but demand it. And that's the key. Different attitude completely. And as us old timers, we just have to stand back and let it happen. And don't get in the way. So I think it's just fantastic what they're doing.
Well, I would say that they would be glad to have you, Mr. Brown, because your impact, I'm sure, will be the impact of everything that you've done and the way that you've touched the lives of students will be felt for a very long time. Well, we really appreciate you being a part of this.
Well, let me tell you.
Sharing your experiences, sharing your voice, reliving things with us. Thank you so much for that. And I'm not sure if Alan may have a question or two for you, if you can give us a little bit more time.
Let me say this before we run out of the battery.
Sure.
I think there's a story to be told, and I am so grateful. When I got a call from one of the students that, Mr. Brown, we're going to have a documentary, there is a story to be told. Because those kids in 1971 did a heck of a job at moving the thinking of the system. And they were fantastic. And they influenced a lot of kids at other high schools because they were really on top of their game. So I appreciate you guys doing this wholeheartedly. And I am happy to do anything I can to help you make it successful.
Thank you. Alan, did you have anything that you wanted to ask Mr. Brown?
Sure, Mr. Brown. I will ask my questions now because of resources. So that's just the PC is going to die because I can't charge it in the outlet here. But I'll tell you, and I'm recording to the cloud, but we've got everything on the camera. It's been incredible to me. I would love it if we could talk again. And with that, I have so many questions. I know that it's not only me, but then also our executive producer, Simone Drake, just listening to you, you inspired so many questions and ideas, and I would love to talk to you. Maybe we sit down for coffee or something.
Oh, I would love to. Anytime I'm available.
I had a couple questions in mind, but then as you talked, so many more things came up, and I'm looking forward to talking to you about that.
Okay.
Thank you, sir. Celia, anything else you want to ask?
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. So that was muffled, so I couldn't hear the last bit of what you said.
I said that we're okay. We're going to hopefully talk again in the near future. We're all set from here. I think Simone said she wasn't going to ask questions, but he was inspired.
Right. I just got that. Okay, great. Well, Mr. Brown, thank you again very, very much. And I will be in touch with you for sure in the coming days. And I look forward to talking to you again, but thank you again. I can't tell you how much we appreciate this and how valuable it was.
Well, yeah. And before thank you for inviting me.